when we do artificial intelligence to estimate the severity and extent of food security in an area of the world, we're not doing it for the website, we're doing it to help those people. My role is to help the organization leverage the opportunities of digital to inform our response, make us a better partner, and make sure food aid reaches those who need it most. My journey mirrors the opportunities that exist in today's world. When I started 20 years ago with WFP, analysis was very different from what it is today. 2012, this was a moment where more and more people in the developing world in humanitarian context actually had access to cell phone services. And we figured out that we were able to run surveys through mobile in a lot of places in the world. We started with a pilot in Goma, the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo, one of the most vulnerable communities you can imagine. And we provided them with cell phones and a charging station. And we started running questionnaires with a group of about 200 people in this camp. And we realized that by providing connectivity, we were getting more information on food security, but we're also helping people. We actually have a story where a family was reunited because of the phones we provided. They were able to call and get information on a family member that had been separated from the others. And that was immediately scaled up during the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. And what mobile surveying did for WFP was get information from parts of Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone that were cut off and quarantined during the Ebola outbreak. In the old days, if there was an area that was cut off, it was a no-go area. We didn't know what was going on. But thanks to mobile telephony, we were able to say, here's what's going on in these areas. And the people in the Ebola-affected areas, they would tell us a lot about what was going on, how they suffered from lost access to markets. Some people in Ebola-affected areas were actually sitting on piles of food they couldn't sell anymore, so they had food but no money. In other areas, there were deficits and food prices were rising, and that we were able to describe in great detail thanks to mobile surveys. And that was scaled to other situations, other humanitarian contexts in the world, including Iraq, Syria, Yemen, the large emergencies that WFP responds to. We've used satellite imagery for decades. We started using satellite imagery to understand how crops were doing. What's gone on with the satellite space is that we've developed many more capacities in addition to that. And the information we get through satellite is much more granular. We've worked with imagery that NASA and other space agencies make available to the public. And we use that to understand crop conditions on the ground. How's the crop done? How bad is that drought? How have the floods impacted crop conditions? What's really changed things over the past 5 to 10 years has been the arrival of private companies that send up micro satellites. These satellites can be built in a day, so they're very cheap to make, and there are many more of them, and they beam back in real-time high-resolution imagery, so we can do much more. We're getting information about settlements, about people. Has the built environment changed? We can, for instance, see from one image to the next whether displaced people have arrived in a specific location. We can see if the roads have been cut off. And the real trick for us is to combine these data streams. We've got data coming in through mobile, you've got data coming in through satellite, and then you've got other data that comes in through traditional means, and bringing it together into one platform can enhance our understanding of a food crisis. This is where AI comes in. What WFP's developed is something we call the Hunger Map Live. It brings together all these information streams into one place. Crops, vegetation, indices, all that comes from satellites, food prices, household level information on coping, food consumption, and all that's used to predict food security at the household level. The best use of this that I've heard was in Yemen, where we faced a renewed conflict in part of the country, and the Hunger Map was telling us, you've got a problem in this part of the country. And what WFP was able to do in Yemen was to increase rations and also increase the number of beneficiaries. So when we do artificial intelligence to estimate the severity and extent of food security in an area of the world, we're not doing it for the website, we're doing it to help those people. And those people benefit from more rations, and more people are eligible for food aid thanks to these tools. So I was sent to Afghanistan to lead the food security cluster for a few weeks. They needed a boost after the Taliban arrived in Kabul. The first thing I worked on was what we call the IPC. That's the Integrated Food Security Phase Classification. It's a big word that means the evaluation of the food security situation in the country. What that involved was getting 20 agencies into a room with all the data we had on Afghanistan to classify food security in the country in the same way we classified in all other countries in the world. And the results were sobering. This all started with a drought, not with the Taliban arrival in Kabul. The drought in the winter of 2020-2021 had been severe. It was the worst that the country had faced in many years. But then, of course, the arrival of the Taliban and the sanctions that were placed onto the country caused the economy to collapse. So we all of a sudden had a covariate national food crisis taking place. And we assessed that the entire country was facing a humanitarian crisis, not just the rural areas that were affected by the drought, but also the cities of Afghanistan. And a city like Kabul is 4 to 6 million people. WFP's executive director has talked about a slow march towards famine, and we need to be very careful that Afghanistan doesn't end up in that situation. We're not there yet. The assessment is that Afghanistan is facing a very serious food crisis. Some parts of Afghanistan are facing an emergency, and we need help now to avoid the worst. The reason I do what I do has to do with my family history. My mother came to the U.S. from Haiti. I remember a day I was with my uncle in a boat. We were going to the Kaimit, which is an island group off Haiti, and the motor went dead. And there's nothing we could do. The engine wouldn't start, and we tried priming it. We pulled on the cord. So we're sitting there for a few hours. We see a boat with an engine come and pick us up. They figured out it was the spark plugs were bad. While they're changing the spark plugs, I'm sitting there, and I see there's a commotion. And I see an old man sitting down. A crowd around him, and he's got blood coming down the side of his head. I'm listening to the conversation, and I understand that this guy just been in a fight with his son over a piece of land. And the reason why the father was disconsolate is that he'd actually thrown a rock on his own son. And I understood that there were issues more important than being lost at sea. The problems were that people there didn't even have enough land to the point where a father and his son could fight over it. That's one of the moments in my life that brought me to this work. Having worked at WFP for 20 years has been a way to come to grips with those types of issues and the solutions that need to be put in place to avoid that happening.